video, we are going to cover Citrix NetScaler ADC MPX Physical Appliance Initial Configuration. This video is part of the Citrix NetScaler training series that I am doing. What we are going to cover in this video is NetScaler MPX Physical Connectivity, then the initial configuration. After that, we need to verify the firmware, because generally NetScaler will be shipped with old firmwares. So we need to verify the firmware, and then we need to update the firmware. Once we verify the firmware, we will discuss about configuring one arm or two arm or multi-arm mode. So in your environment, when you are implementing the NetScaler, first you need to design the solution, right? So when you design your NetScaler based on your requirement, it will fall under either one arm or two arm or multi-arm mode. So what we will do, we will discuss how to configure these things. We'll show you how to do it. And finally, we will go through the interfaces, and we'll discuss about the routing. Now let's move on to the physical connectivity. This is a NetScaler back panel. Most of the NetScalers look like this. So I will not go very detailed into this. If you want to know details of all the hardware components of NetScaler, please refer to the NetScaler hardware components video that I'm leaving in the description below. First, you will connect the power supply in the back panel. By default, one supply will come. If you have ordered additional supply, you will have to. You will mount the NetScaler and you will connect the power supplies. Once you connected the NetScaler to the power supply, by default, the NetScaler, when it is shipped from the Citrix, the NetScaler will be configured with this IP 192.168.100.1. So if you want to know that which firmware and what is the IP, just click on this button and wait for a few seconds. You will see the IP here, NetScaler IP. So what you need to do, first you need to connect your laptop, to the management port. This is the management port. So this is LOM port. It is management port. So it is 0/1, if you see in the physical box. You need to connect this to a laptop, and in your laptop, in the network card, give your laptop some IP in 192.168.100 series, like 192.168.100.10, something like that. Then what happens? You will connect to this with the browser and log in as nsroot is username, nsroot password. If you want to know all the details about every single port and connectivity here, how to do all these things, are listed in the hardware configuration video which I have done. I left the link in the description below. Please have a look at it. Our NetScaler is power on, and it is connected to the we had connected the cross cable from the laptop to the NetScaler, and we gave the IP 192.168.100.1, and NetScaler is up. So nsroot. Once you log in, you will see the NetScaler IP 192.168.100.1, and the subnet mask. It is asking for subnet IP, host name and licenses. But in any typical environment, like in your case, you will not use this IP, right? What you will use, you will use your own IP. So the first thing in NetScaler, we need to change the NetScaler IP details. So we will see how to do it. Connect to the NetScaler using the PuTTY. Login as nsroot and nsroot. Yeah, once you logged into the NetScaler, as you can see here, I'll clear this. First type shell. So you are in shell prompt now. Then type nsconfig. Once you type nsconfig, it's like you are doing the changes to the factory reset one. So first it will ask you, it will give you a couple of options. Like first is the NetScaler IP, mask, advanced, network configuration and time zone and stuff. Time zone, other things you can do later. Our motive now is just to change the NetScaler IP address and subnet mask if it is different for you. So in my case, it is 192.168.2.220. Press enter. Then it will ask you for the mask. Type the mask. In my case, it is /24, so I'll put the same. Now, as you can see here, it is showing my new NetScaler IP and mask. You need to press 7 to apply the changes and exit. Other things even you can do from the GUI. So I'll go ahead, I'll press 7 and I'll say enter. Now it is asking, do you want to save the configuration? Yes. Type yes. Do you want to reboot the system? Yes. We need to type yes. Now the NetScaler will be rebooted. As you can see here, we lost the PuTTY connectivity. Netscaler will be rebooted. After it is rebooted, we have to connect to the Netscaler using the IP we had given here, which is 192.168.2.220 in the browser. So now you need to change your laptop IP to this IP. So what I will do in my case, I'll just connecting physically to the Netscaler, and I change in my laptop IP for time being. So now my Netscaler is rebooted. I prefer not to connect at this point to the network, for reason being the Netscaler physical appliance doesn't have default route. So even though you connect to the network, the routing will not be there. So better to give your laptop an IP in the same subnet as Netscaler IP. Connect laptop directly to the Netscaler to the same management port. Don't connect any other port in the Netscaler to the network at this point. Yeah. So now my Netscaler is up and I will log in NSroot and NSroot. So as you can see here, Netscaler IP is there, subnet mask is there. Now we need to give the subnet IP. In my case, the subnet IP is 192.168.2.221. Click on done. Then we need to provide the host name, DNS, time zone, and even the NTP. Click on that. Provide the host name, DNS, and time zone. Click done. Once you are done, what happens? It will ask you to save the configuration and reboot. Click yes. The Netscaler will reboot. Now my Netscaler has been rebooted. It came up. So just NSroot. Go to system network and interfaces. As you can see here, system network interfaces. Then you can see I have 0/1. Generally 0/1 is your management interface where you will connect the Netscaler IP, NSIP, right? Now 1.1/1 is on the right hand side. If you want to know more details about this, please refer to the hardware configuration video, which I left the link in the description below. 1/1, in my case, what I will do now, first I will start with 1-arm mode, 2-arm mode and multi-arm mode. So what we will do, first we'll do only 1-arm mode with only one interface, right? 1/1. Then 2-arm mode with two interfaces, the multi-arm mode with three interfaces. So I'll use all the interfaces in the last. See, 1-arm mode, 2-arm mode, multi-arm mode is nothing. It's very easy. If you want to know the details about all these 1-arm, 2-arm, multi-arm mode, I had created a separate video. It's purely theory and it's very in-depth. It will explain you even the basics of switching and routing also. Please refer to that. The link is in the description below. Yeah, for us to configure the 1-arm, 2-arm, multi-arm mode, it's very simple. First, we need to know our design. Actually, the 1-arm mode looks like this, where you will have Netscaler will have only one interface. Your NSIP can be in any interface, that's different. We are talking about only the data traffic. So you will have one interface and you will have one VLAN where VIP and SNIP will be there. So this is 1-arm mode. If you talk about 2-arm mode, you will have VIP in one interface and subnet IP in different interface. Meaning to say the traffic will go from one interface and go back from other interface to the backend servers, So we will see this also. So, and the third case is, let's say we have multiple arms, like this is DMG, this is development, this is production. So let's say, if you have a VIP is this and backend servers are this, the traffic will flow from VIP to the backend servers like this. So this is a typical multi-arm mode. So finally, we will configure like this. The same IPs I will configure in the Netscaler. Please remember this, routing table and these IPs now. First, when we need to configure the 1-arm mode, like we have discussed, what we have to do, we need to add the subnet IPs, because VIPs are something which we'll configure later when we are configuring services, but subnet IP is something very important. So click on system network IPs and click on add. You need to give the IP address. So in my case, it is 192.168.10.11. is my subnet IP. The mask is 255.255.255.0. It is the type is subnet IP. Select the subnet IP as type. Come down. No need to do anything here. Just say create. So what I'm trying to do now, I am not only adding one subnet IP. This subnet IP is for my DMZ. I have another subnet IP for my development and production. I will add them also. So as we can see here, I have added three subnet IPs. One 192.168.10.11, this is for my DMZ. Another one for my development. This one 1010 is for my production. means it's for different zones, you know. So typically in your environment, most of the customers you will have either one arm mode or two arm mode. One arm mode means you will have only one subnet IP. Two arm mode means you will have two subnet IPs like this, you know. Now let's go to the network and VLANs. Click on add and create the VLAN. Let's say my DMZ VLAN is 10 and what I am alias name, I will put DMZ. Interface binding, I will use 1/1. As we know, 0/1 is only for management. Now we can see something called tagged here. What is tagged? If your switch port where you connected this 1/1 interface on the switch on the other end, if it is a trunk port, the network team will generally allow the VLAN ID 10 on their trunk. Then you need to select the tagged here because your VLAN is your port is on a trunk port. But in my case, it is an access port, so I am not tagging here. Okay, if it is trunk, you need to tag. Then click on IP bindings. When you click on IP bindings, you can see all the subnet IPs here. So in my case, I have 192.168.10.11 is my subnet IP, right, for DMZ. I'll select this and I'll come down and I'll say create. So the moment I say that, you can see here the interface has come from here to here. Now it is one arm mode. All you need to check is only routing. The physical appliance will never be shipped with the default route, which is 0000. So you need to add the default route. Always it's recommended to add the default route to the DMZ interface. Or let's say if you have one arm mode, you have one interface, right? Your subnet IP is 192.168.10.11 and for that subnet the gateway is 10.1. You need to put the default route gateway as 10.1. So I'll click on add and I will add the network. What I'm doing, I'm creating the default route, right? Network is 0000, netmask is 0000 and gateway is 192.168.10.1, which is my one arm mode subnet IP gateway. That's it. Click on create. Once you click on create, the default route is created, which is C, distance is 1 and a static. So let's say what is default route. If none of the routes which you created are not there, by default, you know, the default route will be selected and all the traffic will be sent to this gateway. That is the meaning of default route. Now with this, actually your one arm mode is done. Means you implemented one arm mode, you know, you have one interface and you tagged the IP, subnet IP to that interface and you created default route. Now let's say you want to go to two arm mode where you have, you know, where, you know, you want to send the traffic to the backend servers from a different subnet IP, you know, then what you will do, it's very simple. Go to the VLANs. It is two arm mode now. If you are what I am creating, let's say my development VLAN ID is 110. This is say dev VLAN. Right, 1/2 is for development. I am not tagging because mine is access port. If it is trunk, please tag it. Click on binding and you need to select the subnet IP of dev. See, for me subnet IP is 172.16.10.11, right? Select it and click create. That's it. Now once you created this, you need to go to the routing and you need to create a static route. Now what you need to do, the static route is very simple. My development super subnet is 172.16. So I'll allow anything in that VLAN, 255.255 means, I mean to say, anything in this, my gateway is this, means the subnet IP of the development VLAN, you know, will be used. This is the meaning of it. And say create. So now this static route is created, right? So with this, your two arm mode is done. With this, the two arm mode is done. Let's say this production is not at there, you know. So what we created the DMZ, we created internal. So even though you have VIPs, you don't have VIPs, you need to create the subnet IP because it's a two arm mode, right? Let's say your virtual IP is this and backend servers are these, you know, what happens then in two arm mode, your traffic will come to the virtual IP like this and it will be sent to the NetScaler using the SNIP, because how the SNIP will know? Because you created a default route for this subnet 172.16.0.0, right? So who is in that subnet? This SNIP. And which interface? You already created a VLAN and you tagged it, right? So that's how NetScaler will know and it will be sent to the gateway which you created in the default, in the static route, right? Then the traffic will be sent back, or the whatever traffic coming from the backend servers will be sent to the NetScaler. Now if the NetScaler don't know some other traffic, right, it will be by default sent to the DMZ interface because that is a default route. So 2-arm mode is very simple. This is 2-arm mode configuration. Now let's move to multi-arm mode. System network VLAN, create another VLAN. Let's say my production VLAN 210 and name I had given. Just scroll down. I'm selecting the interface third one because first two we already used, right? I'm not tagging because mine is access port. Go to the IP binding, again scroll down and select the 10.10.10.11. This is a subnet IP for production, right? Click on create. So now what happens? Another interface is gone. So every interface has its own VLAN. So meaning to say, what we are trying to tell is here that we created a VLAN, and with that VLAN, we are binding the interface to the subnet IP. Same, this is for DMZ, this is for development, this is for production. This is how NetScaler will know. And the final thing we need to do, just to create one route. That's it. Go to the routes and my production, let's say supernet is 10.0.0.0 and mask is this, means anything after 10, right? Because I'm mask, I put only 255, anything after 10, you know, I am sending the back traffic back to 10.10.10.1, meaning to say this is the gateway and the subnet IP which is in this VLAN will be used. Click on create. Now that's it. With this, you know what you have done? You have done the multi-arm mode implementation. It's very simple. So how the traffic flows? Let's see again. So how the traffic flows for multi-arm mode? Just when a user traffic is coming to the VIP, let's say for this VIP, these are your backend servers. The traffic will flow from here. It will go back. And let's say you have another VIP called 192.168.10.15. And these are your backend servers. The traffic will go back using this SNIP. All it is happening because of the static routes you have created. I have shown you how to create, right? The default route to always the DMZ interface. And if you have 2-arm mode, whatever is your backend servers, all the servers, you can create individual subnets, static route, or maybe the preferred is a super subnet, and create that to the gateway of your internal SNIP. If you have multi-arm mode, as I had shown you, each zone static route to that. We have implemented the multi-arm mode design. First we have seen 1-arm mode, then 2-arm mode, then multi-arm mode. If you want to know the theory of it, because I showed you the practical, just have a look at the video in the description below. Then if you see this video, it will make a lot of sense for you. Now we'll see the licensing. Go to system licensing, click on manage license and add license and upload the license here. NetScaler will be rebooted and your license will be applied. Whenever NetScaler is shipped, it will be generally shipped with very old firmware. In my case, it is shipped with 12.0.63.13. You know, it's very old firmware. Now latest is 12.1 came and 13.0 came. So I want to update to the latest one. How I need to update the firmware? Just go to Citrix.com, downloads, select Citrix ADC, then come down firmware section under wherever you want. Click on the firmware. Once you click on the firmware, go down. It's called build encore. Just download this. Once you have downloaded, you know, go to the NetScaler. In my case, I already downloaded it. Go to the system, you know, system upgrade. Click on it. Select choose file. It's in the desktop. Select it. Open. You know, I have chosen the file. Just say upgrade. That's it. First, it will copy the complete package, you know, to the NetScaler. And after that, it will upgrade. Now the NetScaler firmware is uploaded and automatically it will start the installation, as you can see here. We need to wait for some time. The time depends on how heavy the firmware is. Sometimes it takes like 5 minutes. Sometimes even I have seen half an hour. As you can see here, the installation has been completed and a reboot is required for the configurations to take effect, you know. Once it is done, click on reboot to reboot the NetScaler. NetScaler has been rebooted, so let's log in. Please verify the firmware has been updated, that now the new firmware is NS13. The new firmware is NS13. You can click here and see. Thanks for watching the video. Please like and subscribe to the channel. Like the video and share with your friends and colleagues. And most importantly, please complete all the videos in this series because it is very helpful and you'll gain a lot of knowledge. If you have any comments, please feel free to leave your comments down. You might be interested in my blog shivashankar.org. It has all the detailed installation and configuration details of most of the products. Thank you.